Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. I hope you guys are all doing all right today. I just wanted to come on here and make a video. I was going to say a quick video. I'd always debate whether I'd make a second one because, you know, I make a video for my regular subscribers and then, you know, I try to make a video for new people, for Jewish people in this case, and non-believers. And, you know, you got different audiences. You cannot cover every topic in every video. So when you go through and give up something there, you know, you can't, if I go back like I normally do lots of times, I try to hit every nail so that when you get these trolls making comments, you know, like I said, every video can't cover every topic or you'd never get anything said new. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to talk about something today about, you know, I made the video that I posted yesterday, so I don't know when I'll post this video because I got three or four videos to post about Alex Jones, to pray for Alex Jones. And I had some people towing the government's line, commenting on the video, saying that, you know, about submitting to the government and all this kind of stuff. So I thought I would make a response to that. Lots of things people don't know, and discuss this thing. Okay, let's get to the facts. For one thing, these people are doing, you talk about doing the work of the government. That's those people. Number two, if you're not sure about Alex Jones, don't watch videos of people on YouTube talking conspiracies and about Alex Jones. Go listen to Alex Jones' radio show yourself and make your own determination. That's why lots of people, those people who are trolling out there, they are actually what are known by the government as Homer Simpson people. The government mocks people and calls them Homer Simpson people, meaning, and the other term they use, the politically correct term, is low information people. So the word low information is just a politically correct way by the government to say that you're ignorant. That's what it means. You have a lack of information, low information people. So let's talk about Romans 13, and let's talk about what the government of the United States is doing. I want you to listen to me. I don't usually talk about any too much political stuff, but there's a point where, you know, the natural meets the spiritual. And this is an example. Now, and this is the truth. You can, and I'll try to put the links if I remember. There's always, I know I see on other people's videos when I first got on YouTube and started making videos in 2011, I saw people, you know, they'll put comments, you need to put links. Well, go look it up yourself. You know, it's not my personal job to be your, you know, your errand boy and your servant. And I noticed that about, you know, a lot of people keep attacking Paul Begley saying, oh, you need to put links, you need to put links. No, he doesn't need to put links. You can go look it up yourself. Does Brian Williams put links when he makes up stories, whether they be true or not? No. You know, so we all need to get off of our blessed assurance and go use the Google, as President Bush would say, and look these things up ourselves for ourselves and go to the original source. When I see an article from any website, especially the mainstream media, it's suspect. The title, lots of times, the headline of the article doesn't even match what's in the article. I go look for the source information. Where did it come from? What was actually said and done? Not the spin of the writer. So everyone that does reporting puts a spin on it. What they, you know, usually through their own way of seeing things, whether it be Fox News, you know, who try to, you know, they're neocons, neoconservative, not real conservatives. They're warmongers and pro-war, like McCain and all those guys. Those guys aren't conservative. A conservative, someone that wants, like President Washington said, you know, we need to stay out of these foreign, President Washington, when he left office, he said, stay out of the foreign wars. President Eisenhower, when he left office, said, beware of the military-industrial complex. So lots of Christians who are low-information people our Fox News watchers, and it's all drummed up about let's go kill, you know, let's go have wars on the alleged conservative side. It's a neoconservative side. Now, if you know, let's talk truth here. MSNBC and those liberals, they, and the liberal politicians, even Obama, who's half black, they use black people to vote for them, and then they don't do anything for them. Black people are worse off now than they were before. They're bringing in all these foreign immigrants. Why? Illegal immigrants. Why? Because they want to have a North American Union and a one world government. It's, the word is de facto. America has become de facto a multicultural world, nation by default. You know, you wake up one morning and all your neighbors are from another country. That's the man's plan to destroy Christianity, to destroy every culture, to bring in a new world order so that all of your neighbors are foreigners. So what do we have in common? Oh, the dear leader, the Führer. You know, it's German, that they call Hitler, the Führer, the leader. That's what they want. And so they use people. The conservatives use Christians. I don't know if you can understand that. President Bush and all those neocons, the new neoconservatives, go look it up, which are actually liberals masking as, you know, like Bush Sr., Illuminati guy, you know, skull and bones and all that. Bush Sr. was pro-abortion until he ran with Reagan as his partner. You know, they brought him in to control Reagan. They do all of these things from both sides. It's all a bunch of, it's like professional wrestling in the States. That's what politics are. It's like professional wrestling. So you have to stop buying into the talking points of either side, and you have to look at things as a Christian and as a, you know, as a patriot, as a, you know, as someone who supports freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and all those things. So let me give you some facts. The government has a program, and I just slipped my mind. I just looked it up. I usually never look anything up before I make a video, but I looked it up because I wanted to have it right. Pastor's Response Team. Go look it up. Go use the Google. Pastor's Response Team. They used it in New Orleans. It was revealed on the mainstream media at the time of New Orleans. What is it? The government, just like the devil, you know, the difference between the liberals and a true conservative, not the mainstream conservatives like the politicians we have now, rhinos, Republican in name only, those politicians, is they believe in better living through government. The government is God. Government is your provider instead of God is your provider. And like I said, it's not only liberals. All of those rhino Republicans that are in charge of the House now and all those ones, they're sold their soul and they just have a different spin, but they ain't doing nothing. As I mentioned many times before, did President Bush, when he had the House and the Senate, did they overturn Roe v. Wade? Did they do anything? No. No, they did not. As a matter of fact, the Supreme Court justices he nominated are one world people. John Bolton, all these people keep loving that John Bolton, you know, the walrus. He's on Fox News all the time. If you go listen to his speeches, he's a one world government guy. Let me just say this. I'm getting off track here. The difference between the neocons, the Fox News, you know, John McCain and all those guys, these fake conservatives, and the liberals like Obama and Clinton and all those guys, they are Fabian socialists, the liberals, like the British and all that. Their leader for so many years just at this time of Bill Clinton and all this. The leader over there, Tony Blair. Those guys are Fabian socialists, and they want to take over the world and have, you know, one world government through the whole world. They have the Trilateral Commission. Jimmy Carter was a trilateralist. Everybody thinks he was a Christian too. Trilateralists, they want to divide the world into three different regions, trilateral regions. Go look it up. Then the conservatives have the CFR, Council for Foreign Relations, and then they want to have a Anglo-American empire. So guys like John Bolton and the Fox News people, they want the Anglo-American empire to dominate the world and make a one world government through that. And then the liberals want to make a one world government where, you know, America is not in charge, but it's more of an equal thing and divided into three different regions. See, but they both are building a Tower of Babel with the same end result, the kingdom of the Antichrist. It's just they're fighting over which way to get there. That's what people understand. This is truth I'm talking here, truth. Now, the pastor's response team is set in place by the government. As I said, they twist the word of God from Romans chapter 13. And then they went around at Katrina, and they're going to do it when they have martial law. They've got over 50,000 pastors on the payroll of Homeland Security, spying on their congregation now, reporting on their congregation now. Go look these things up. There's articles about it all over the, you know, different media sources. And it's usually like the British are reporting on what's going on here, and then the American press will report on what's going on in England. But there's a blackout of American press covering it. But you can find these things. The American Free Press, the Canadian Free Press websites, different things like that, you can find this information and other sources. I think it's the London Guardian is also come out pro-freedom. Some of their reporters who went to Bilderberger and the police threatened them there in Greece. Then they realized, hey, there is a man. Yes, there is a cabal to take over this world, the Bilderbergers and all these things. Anyway, Illuminati and whatnot, the devil's people. And so they're twisting Romans 13 to get people to submit to the martial law. And I want to tell you some things about that. Number one, in America, now it's not about the Europeans now, you listen to me. In America, our authority is we the people, the Constitution. So therefore, for America, unlike any other country on earth, praise God, Israel is a unique nation on earth because, you know, God is their king. And the United States, we have self-rule. It says we are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights, some of which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So the way American system was set up, even though there were some Illuminati people and all that, God made a way that we were a Christian nation, not the vision of Sir Francis Bacon. Go look that up. He wanted to make the New Atlantis and all that. Yeah, the Illuminati people, whatever. A lot of them are Masons and whatnot. But God made a way that America became a Christian nation. Plus, the Masonry in those days was pre-Albert Pike Masonry. Nothing like Masonry is today. It was just, the ignorance level among the members was much less then than it is today. Even though, of course, it led to New Age thinking and Renaissance thinking and this Age of Enlightenment and anti-religious thinking. That's absolutely true. But Christianity prevailed in the United States because that was God's plan to use the United States to defend Israel, bring about the rebirth of the nation of Israel, destroying, you know, the fascist Nazis and the you know, Imperial Japan and all those things that America did righteously up until the time of, you know, Vietnam and all this 1960s, which I wrote about in the book. America changed in the 1960s. Removing prayer in school, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, all those things. That's what I wrote about in the book that the Lord gave me to write, the Final Boarding Call. Satan's Plan for the Ages and Our Last Mission. Anyway, brothers and sisters, on this topic. So, we the people are the government, and we have inalienable rights. We have inalienable rights from God, not from government. Government is not our God. And our King is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to say this too. If you will go study your history, you will discover that God sent the Great Awakening before the Revolutionary War, and pastors, preachers were a huge, huge part of the movement of freedom of religion, freedom of speech, and all that. The pilgrims came, talk about up there at Plymouth Rock, and even before that, Jamestown, 1607, all that. Those people came because of religious persecution, brothers and sisters. America was founded, number one, first, freedom of religion. That was why they call them pilgrims. They were on a religious pilgrimage. The Puritans up there in Plymouth Rock. And you can talk about all the history and what ended up happening to the Indians and all that. That is all true, but not the point. You know, let's focus on the point that God raised the United States up as a Christian nation, as a unique nation. No matter what the, you know, the liberals think and what Obama thinks, America is an exceptional nation on a mission from God. Not like the Blues Brothers claim they were on a mission from God. America is on a mission from God. And that's almost complete as we hand the baton to Israel to take their place center stage. Israel is the center stage. Jerusalem is the center of that, and the Temple Mount is the stage in the world. As God said, I will make it a cup of trembling in Zechariah. I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling and a stumbling block to the whole world to try to touch it and mess with it in those last days. Brothers and sisters, we the American Christians and all Christians in the world, when the United States goes down, even though, look, we Christians want the rapture to happen, we want the Lord to return and all that, but listen to me, when America goes, we're the only ones with this Constitution and freedom of religion, freedom of speech. Even though America is nothing like it was, you know, the America pre-1960s, pre the assassination of President Kennedy, put it that way, that time frame, early 60s, is the beacon of light, and that shining city on a hill, as President Reagan said, that is true. We're the Christian version of Israel. That is true, brothers and sisters. And we're in the twilight of that. But we, the power is with we the people, God. It says we are endowed by our Creator. God gave us certain inalienable rights. Now, it's our job to have those rights and hold those rights. We need to maintain our freedom. Now, and I wanted to tell you this, guys, this. You Gentiles, us American Christians particularly, go see Sergeant York, the movie Sergeant York. I'm sure it's free on YouTube. You can go watch Sergeant York, played by Gary Cooper. Now, he was a very Christian man, and he had a crisis of consciousness. Should he fight in World War I? And he went back home to Tennessee, and he prayed, and he decided that it was the Lord's will that he would go ahead and fight in World War I for what was right, for freedom of religion and speech and all those things, that it was his godly duty to do that. And brothers and sisters, Sergeant York was the most decorated man in World War I. And that's what God wants us to be. You know, freedom isn't free. Look at Israel, all the wars that Israel had to fight for their freedom, World War II and all that. And there, yes, there are people who are conscientious objectors. And yes, you have pastors, you know, you're a chaplain. You know, I was a medic in the Army. I was a medic in the Gulf War. I was there in Iraq and Kuwait and Saudi Arabia. I've been all over this place. I was in the war there as a medic. And praise God, I didn't have to shoot nobody. But I would have if that's what it would have required as my duty. So that's what you want to look at, Romans 13 and all that. And you want to think, you believe, let the devil twist the word of God. God appoints authority. That's why we have policemen. That's why the Ten Commandments doesn't say thou shalt not kill. In the Hebrew, it says thou shalt not murder. And not even to stay on the point of what that word says, read the law. Read the law. It says if you kill someone and it's a justified killing, then it's not a crime under the law. When you waylay and wait and premeditate to kill somebody, that's murder. If you kill someone by accident while you're fighting and you're both at fault, it's manslaughter. You know, you accidentally run over somebody and kill them. It's manslaughter. So you have these, you know, different things. Or self-defense, I was, you know, saying that. Self-defense, of course, you'd be innocent. If it was proven it was self-defense, it depends on what happened. All those details, that's all from the law. American law is based off the law of Moses, the Torah. So that's why God said in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not murder, not thou shalt not kill. Because there are times for justifying killing. And the Bible says God is the one that raises up police. So police are needed to bring law and order in the natural world. See, people twist the word of God and it's just like cliches to them. You know, thou shalt judge not, thou shalt be not judged. Well, God also sets judges, the government to judge. It means if I get mad at you, I'm not supposed to judge you. And when I look at you and I say, well, this guy looks like his hair is long, he's some old hippie looking dude, he's going to hell. That's the kind of judging that the Lord's talking about. Not the government, you know, a judge or a group of people judging, like it says, let us judge among ourselves, the elders of the church judging somebody, whether they're living in sin and they need to repent, or you're going to excommunicate them or whatever. It talks about in the Bible. Paul talks about 1 Corinthians, putting somebody out of the church if they don't repent, sleeping with his father's wife, like his stepmom. And Paul said, you know, you need to turn him over to Satan until he'll repent. And the guy did repent and come back there in 2 Corinthians. We see it. So there's those kind of people get confused. It's like, you know, when someone strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other. That's talking about if you and me argue and you punch me, I'm supposed to forgive you. It's not talking about as an agent of the government and you're a policeman or you're in the army. You know, you don't turn the other cheek. You're acting in the authority. You're talking about the authority of the government. You know, people are looking at it from backwards. Oh, you need to surrender and submit, take the mark and all this. No. The tribulation saints aren't supposed to take the mark. So they're going to use Romans 13 to get people to take the mark. Can you understand that? Looks like Martin Luther King. The reason why he was victorious, and people said, well, he had communist beliefs and all that. Well, whatever. He was a pastor. He took a Christian stand, and he's shamed. He's shamed. Not only did they pray and all that, and they say, well, you know, things about him, that he was communist, he was a womanizer, whatever, the FBI was spying on him. That's beside the point. Nobody's perfect. That has nothing to do. People always like to cloud the issue. It was a Christian thing to end segregation. And Martin Luther King, through the anointing of the Holy Spirit, was used by God. And then the Christians in the South were shamed into realizing that what they were doing, making black people sit in the back of the bus and having a colored water fountain and all that, colored bathroom, and they had to go to the back door of the restaurant or the back door of the courthouse and all that. They saw that it was an unchristian thing to do, just like before with slavery. Old Willebrand, there in England. Old Willebrand, you know, he died before the end of slavery, but, you know, he was a member of Parliament in England, or the House of Lords, I don't remember. But he campaigned against slavery there long before it was cool anywhere else. And, you know, it ended up starting the movement, ended slavery in England, and then in the New England states they ended it, and then the abolition movement was a Christian movement. And by the way, for all my friends who watch my videos who are Southern Baptists, who I always criticize about, you know, bordering on blaspheming the Holy Spirit, the Southern Baptist denomination was started by pro-slavery people. They broke off over slavery to be pro-slavery, Southern Baptist. So, this is a whole other video. Let me throw this out there as the Lord is bringing to my attention. I meant to mention this before. Have you ever heard the story with David? Listen to this story, what happened. Joshua was deceived by some people that were in the Holy Land. I feel the Holy Ghost about the Holy Land. And they tricked the Israelites that they were not from there. And they said, oh, can we be your servants and serve you? And then Joshua said, yeah, you can, without consulting the Lord. Then they found out they were actually some local people. Later on, when King David was the king, like 400 or 500 years later, some people were persecuting them and killing them. And then God told David, look, you've spilt the blood of these people who Joshua and the elders made a covenant with. And the land is cursed until you repent of that. The nation repents of that and turns from that. Now, and the Lord is just reminding me, out of the blue, this is awesome. This is somehow connected. I guess it is because of what happened in Ferguson and all that. I didn't even think about it. You know, thank the Lord for the Lord being the one guiding me. I think I mentioned this in a video before in passing. When I first got filled with the Holy Spirit and I started hearing from God, I was an assistant pastor in a Baptist church, and then the pastor started preaching against the Holy Spirit. But most of the people with me, I was new and immature in the Lord, and I didn't want to make any trouble in the church, so I left. And I went to an Assemblies of God church, a mega church, about 5,000 people. And I talked to the pastor, and I was an altar worker there, and I started going to Bible college through Assemblies of God. So I was there during that time, it's 3 or 4 years time frame, and I started working with the Filipinos. Anyway, so while I was there, the Lord gave me a word about where I lived, Winston-Salem, North Carolina. The Lord said He wanted to send revival to Winston-Salem. This is what you need to do. The Lord gave me a word. And I gave the pastor the word, and I gave the message to the largest church where I'm from is the Southern Baptist Church, Calvary Baptist Church. I emailed them the word of the Lord. Of course none of them listened to me. Of course. They never do. That's why there's no revival. And the word of the Lord was this, that if the historical white churches in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where I'm from, would take a cross, a big cross, and have a prayer march to the oldest historical black church in Winston-Salem, and stick that cross in the front yard instead of what the devil did, burning crosses, but that they would kneel down and pray at that cross and repent of, you know, the past of racism and slavery and Jim Crow between black and white people, it would send a reconciliation in the American church. We could go out from there to all of America. This was 2002 or 2003. And it would send a wave of reconciliation, you know, between historical black and historical white churches, and bring unity and revival to the American church. Now, I gave this word to the pastor, and then I emailed him 3 or 4 times. He didn't respond. One of his assistants, because they got, you know, a whole like 12 pastors, you know, and one answers people. And he's, you know, he messaged me and said, oh, the pastor's so busy. Only thing he does 24 hours a day is work on the Sunday morning sermon, which I know for a fact because I was an altar worker. And his secretary was an altar worker. He got his sermons from offline, very unanointed, supposed to be in the Assemblies of God church. And his anointing was, the Baptist church pastor had a stronger anointing than him, you know, and had not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. That's the kind of foolishness you deal with, especially in these mega churches, brothers and sisters. That's why I'm telling you, Jesus was born in a manger. You know, Isuzu Street Revival, 1906, started in a black church. And it was a stable. It was a barn converted to a church in a poor area with black people there. It started, and then, you know, the white people came, like John G. Lake and all these guys. They came and got the fire from this guy Seymour, was the son of a slave from Texas who went there, and that's when the thing broke out. God is always, that's why in the Philippines, most of the churches are little shacks, but the power of the Holy Spirit is so mighty. The Lord is not found in king's castles. He's not found in the government of the United States. He's not found in Homeland Security, you know, tanks and anti-personnel carrier, you know, whatever, armored personnel carriers, APCs that they use against American people. Sound cannons, and all these water cannons and sound cannons and frequency cannons and microwaves that they've got now that they're using for crowd control to fry your brain and all that. They got, go look all that stuff up. The man is for real. And it's the devil. It is the devil. And it's not only, and I'm talking for especially the tribulation saints. You know, there's going to be that crisis of consciousness. There's a Christian movie with Mr. T in it. And it's called, there's a whole series. You can go watch them on YouTube. There's Apocalypse is the first one, produced by Dr. Jack Van Impe and John Hagee. There's Apocalypse, then there's Revelation, then Tribulation, and then Judgment. That fourth one is Judgment. And the guy from, there used to be a show called L.A. Law, and Corin Bernstein is the lawyer on there, of a woman who's a news reporter, famous news reporter that becomes a tribulation saint. And she does all these illegal broadcasts, hijacking a satellite. Ooh, you know, I had people come on my video that we need to submit to authority. Christians need to submit to authority. These tribulation saints, they hijacked the satellite, jacked into the satellite and broadcast Dr. Jack Van Impe giving the gospel and John Hagee giving the gospel and all that during the tribulation and hiding from the man, avoiding the man, refusing to take the mark. So when people tell you to submit to the government, I'm not talking about laws. And that's why I started talking about Martin Luther King, and I'm talking about civil rights and all those things. I'm not talking about laws that we know as a Christian are right. Thou shalt not murder, you know, and all these kind of things, you know, drunk driving or whatever. I'm talking about laws that go against the Word of God. I'm talking about if they tell you, oh, you can't say the name of Jesus, like they're doing now in the military, the Army chaplains, Navy chaplains. You can't say the name of Jesus and all that. There was a Navy chaplain. You know, he got kicked out for that. He's been writing books. I forgot his name. He's going around, you know, trying to, you know, make a legal battle about that with the government. You know, when they have laws that are against our Christian faith, we have to practice civil disobedience, just like what Martin Luther King did. Unjust laws, you know, against our consciousness. So that's why we have to pray about it. It's not anarchy and all this, that, you know, like in Ferguson with the people setting things on fire, but the people that protested against the police, they claim there's, well, the, you know, I don't want to talk about Ferguson. The problem with Ferguson, the police force should reflect the community. I mean, in the natural, we're talking non-Christian statement here, just in the natural. The thing about Ferguson, that the problem there particularly was it was a historically white neighborhood that converted real quickly to a almost all black neighborhood, just in a quick short time. And then the police department was still the people that were been there as career policemen, you know, so that's why the neighborhood changed real quick over a few years. And that's what created the problem there. So just let's a practical solution, not talking Christianity, a practical solution is if a neighborhood is a like in Little Italy in New York, they should have Italian policemen. In China neighborhood, Chinatown, whatever they want to call it, should be Asian policemen. And in a black neighborhood should be mostly black policemen. That way, I mean, you know, this is just practical advice. So there's, you know, there's we need to have better communication. That's just a natural thing. And pastors are involved in it. A lot of times we talk about, you know, just the spiritual stuff. But God calls pastors. In Ferguson, there were pastors, black pastors, mostly black pastors. And it should have been more white pastors there, getting in between the police and the protesters, not the people setting buildings on fire. And I believe those were provocateurs, because we're talking about the topic of the man. There were outsiders, agitators, paid hacks of Soros who were there starting those fires in Ferguson. That's what they say, organizing them, you know, inciting teenagers to do it or whatever. You know, kind of like what the Special Forces does, like with this Operation Jade Helm. The Special Forces, their specialty. I was in the military for 10 years. What the Special Forces does, I had lots of friends in the Rangers and the Green Berets. And what they do, the Green Berets go into a place and they create a counterinsurgency. They train the local people. They indoctrinate the local people to be on the side of what the American government wants. And then they create a fighting force. And they go out and do even sabotage and, you know, unconventional warfare. Talk about terrorist attacks, false flags, all this stuff. That's what happens. That's the specialty. PsyOps. Psychological operations. That's what's going on. So we need to stick with the truth. And there are times, you know, guys have watched my videos. You know, I'm one of the most spiritual people there is, way out there when it comes to hearing from God and all those things. But in the practical world, the job of Christians and preachers is to be, blessed are the peacemakers. I'm not talking about the One World Peace Treaty. I'm talking about peace between black and white people in America and, you know, Hispanic people or whatever. Because the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. There is nothing wrong with ever trying to make peace and negotiate with people from different groups and have peace and be salt and light to them. And there's also a time, and like World War II is a great example, when there is real evil, like ISIS. There is real evil in this world, and a lot of the people who have to go there as fighters are Christians. And there's a time to stand up to real evil when it crosses over our religious freedom. And that's what we have to protect, brothers and sisters. America is the last on this earth, manifestation on this earth, of the kingdom of God manifest on earth of salt and light. Because we have that constitution. The Canadians don't have the constitution that we have. The British and all those guys, they don't have the constitutional rights like what we have. They're subjects of the Queen of England. We are not subjects. We are citizens. We are the government. We submit to ourselves. We the people. We the people. And that's been a beacon in this world since the time of the creation of the United States. And that's been our job, brothers and sisters. So until the Lord comes, gets his church, we need to be ready to stand. You know, get off of Facebook, get off of the, you know, the fluorinated tap water and all those things, and get off the hormone-filled food that's making us, you know, fat and sloppy and lazy and brain dead, and wake up and be ready to be salt and light and get out there and move. And I guess I better cut it off. So I'm calling for the church. We got prayer. I can't even get Christians to pray. Hardly at all. There's some of you guys who pray. I'm not saying that. But it's hard to, you know, rally the church to pray. That's why the devil's children come in arguing about doctrines. Now, I'm not talking about, I have to repeat this because, you know, people, if you don't say everything in every video, I'm not talking about Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and cults and all that. I'm talking about born-again Christians who are defined as evangelical and Pentecostal born-again Christians. You know, you're talking Baptist, all different types, Assemblies of God, Church of God, whatever, all along in there. I didn't name every denomination, but born-again Christians. We have to unite in prayer. One voice, black, white, Hispanic, whatever. All different races, creeds. We need to unite to become one new man with the Israelites too who become born again, Messianic Jews and all that. We need to unite for God's purposes, brothers and sisters. We are the army of God. So one time the famous question was asked, and I heard R.C. Sproul talking about this, who's a Calvinist, by the way, but a brilliant man. He said, someone stood up and asked him, one of the young people in his church, and said, is the church a hospital or an army? And the answer that came in my mind was what he gave. We're both. We're here as a hospital for those who come to us for help, but we're an army against the devil's people. We're an army on the march and a hospital. Because that's a unique thing about it. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities and forces and darkness in high places. Manifested through people. So when those people are fighting against Christianity, we stand against them. But we're ready to receive them when they're ready to repent. They become our brothers and sisters when they turn to the Lord. So we need to attack on all fronts. Prayer, evangelism, speaking out, standing up. Christians need to have nonviolent protests and all that stuff like what Martin Luther King did. And people need to get mobilized. And God uses preachers. Martin Luther King was a preacher. Martin Luther King Jr. was a preacher. Martin Luther was a priest who became a preacher. You know, the revolutions God used are with preachers when God's doing it. And sometimes there's violence, and by grace of God, it's nonviolent. You know, and that's what we got to pray for. Pray that God would not let, you know, there's a big chance of civil war in the United States. Racial war. The man wants to have a racial war in the United States. Lots of things. That's why they're bringing in all those Muslims. They want to have another 9/11. That's what they're gaming for. They're just chomping at the bits. Who, the neocons, want another 9/11. I'm talking about the Fox News people. The neocons, they want another 9/11. So they can dominate the world. They have these six fantasies. You got the Monsanto poisoning the food with GMOs and all that. Bill Gates, who says we need to reduce and wants to reduce the world population down to less than 500 million, but he gives immunizations all over the world. A man that says he wants to do away with 90% of the world's population and gives you an immunization. You think that immunization is going to help you? Let's use common sense. This is just basic. basic intelligence required here to understand what's going on in this world. I've just touched on a handful of things, brothers and sisters. And these are not conspiracy theories. They're facts. Go get on to Google. That's why the man hates the free internet. And that's why they're trying to regulate and take over the internet now. Because they want to do away with this information. The internet's been the greatest blessing to the world and the greatest curse with pornography and all that. And the man surveilling us. Everybody says, oh, I don't want to be on Facebook because they're surveilling us. Yeah. But also on the Facebook, we can have the pictures of the orphans and stuff. And what's going on in the world. And on the internet, we can find out about the GMOs and all that stuff. Even though they use the internet to monitor us. They use it for pornography. But I can use it to post a Christian video. So it's a double-edged sword, brothers and sisters. Let's use every avenue available to us to win and conquer the enemy. We are here to occupy till the Lord comes. We're supposed to be taking the world by force, the spiritual force of the Holy Spirit, as we are led by God. Let's be that army of God. Let's be strong in the Lord, in the power of His might. Stop being weak and wimpy. Jesus is not on the cross anymore. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords in victory. Read Revelation chapter 1. That's Jesus. He already suffered for us. He's got the victory now. He's overcome the world. And we are in Him. Whatever Jesus has got, we got. He's overcome the world. We've overcome the world through Christ. We've overcome death, hell, and the grave. The world, the flesh, and the devil is underfoot. Where's your faith? Stop looking with the natural eyes of what the man's doing and overcome it by faith in what God can do. All things are possible to those who believe. With God, all things are possible. Greater is He who's in us than he who's in the world. Hallelujah. 1 John 4:4. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8. We've got the victory, brothers and sisters. Don't let the man... You're going to listen to Obama or any of these politicians try to use the word of God and tell the church what to do? No way! No way is the devil going to try to tell me what to do. That's what he did to Eve. Oh, did God really say? No, God don't want you to eat the fruit because you'll become like him. Don't ever let the devil tell you what the word of God says. When you're talking government, you're talking the devil. Go read when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, the devil said, if you'll bow down and worship me, he showed Jesus all the kingdoms in a point in a moment. He showed Jesus the kingdoms of the world all through time. And said, if you'll bow down and worship me, I'll give you these kingdoms. Because it's in my power to do so. Jesus didn't say, oh, it's not in your power. No, Jesus even said later that Satan was the god of this world. The Bible says he's the principality of the air and the god of this world. And Jesus, even in the Garden of Gethsemane, said that. Until Jesus returns, Satan is the god of this world. Adam surrendered that authority to him. Jesus has reclaimed the spiritual for us in the spirit. But the flesh has not been redeemed yet till the Lord returns, that he will redeem this world. When he opens up those seven seals, that's the title deed to the earth. Then he will reclaim the authority over, and physically take over the earth and destroy all sin. Hell and the grave will be swallowed up in victory and all those things, brothers and sisters. Until that time. Something else I was trying to tell you. I was trying to think of what it was. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God. Bless His holy name. This is a call to action. It's always a lot of talk. And those people coming on here spouting doctrines and all that. God didn't call us to major in the minors of all every little detail. People want to know every little detail and understand every little detail about every doctrine. God called us to go and make disciples of the nations. We should spend, unless you're a pastor, you don't need to spend every waking minute studying doctrine. We need to get out there and evangelize people, reach people for lost and all those things. And then you never know everything. I saw a video. There was a dude, I don't know his name. His channel is B. Rouge, like Baton Rouge. B. Rouge, I guess maybe he lives in Baton Rouge. B. Rouge is his channel, and he had a near-death experience as a child when he was 10 years old. He posted a video about it. And then some people were on there telling him all this, oh, there's no such thing as the Trinity, and all this doctrinal stuff. This dude made a video of how he died and went to heaven and Jesus is real and all that stuff for non-believers. And some old devil tear Judaizer is on there putting some Judaizer stuff on there. Alleged Christian doing the work of the devil, clouding up the issue and disturbing the opportunity for someone to hear just the pure gospel told from a guy who died and went to heaven at 10 years old. He's a grown man now, I think he's 40s, and he's telling this story for the first time. Be rouged. And then the devil's children on there, thinking they're doing the work of God, doing nothing but the work of the devil, blocking the door to heaven. So Jesus was right when he said, you block the door to heaven, you won't go in yourselves, and you won't let anybody else go in. Get out of the way. Get out of the way to the door to heaven. Let God deal with his people. Move out of the way. Stop standing between Jesus and his people. You know, as Jesus said, you're a thorn in the feast. You know, you're a thorn in the rose bush. God bless you guys. You know, brothers and sisters, you know, 99% of you guys is not talking to you, and you know that. Praise God. But by the grace of God, let those trolls come on here and hear it. At least they have heard it. And they can give an account to the Lord for not obeying him. God bless you guys. You know that I love you guys. And praise God for his Holy Spirit. I'm working on the words list for you guys. I just want to jump on here and make this video. Lord's been dropping so much stuff on me, guys. It's not even funny, man. All of this stuff about Israel and helping Israel. And, you know, it's just we're on the countdown to the rapture, brothers and sisters. I'm going to be on a radio show by the grace of God at the last week of May. And I'll announce it when it gets closer. Talking about the dream I had of the Lord turning, you know, in the four different directions. And the Lord keeps giving me different levels. Excuse me, different levels of interpretation of that. Even the Alex Jones dream I had, as Brother Gary, I think, was telling me, Bear 049 was telling me, yeah, that talked about, you know, that Alex Jones had to be, no, what Brother Gary was telling me is how I gave a word on his video from interpretation of tongues and saying that, you know, that the Lord says shout to the north, south, east, and west. That's what Brother Gary Bear 049 was telling me. But someone commented on my video, the Alex Jones video, and saying that, you know, 6 o'clock means, you know, like it's almost dark, something like that. And so that's true. That also ties in with the video that I made, you know, 6 o'clock being going to dark, nighttime, representing the tribulation, brothers and sisters. You know, the time that the tribulation would start, you know, at nighttime. But it's also, anyway, so it's all these different layers, brothers and sisters. So I need to make a video, go back and pray about it, make a more detailed video about the vision that the Lord gave me, because there's so many layers and levels to it, and I thank the Lord for that. I think the Lord is using me more in these kind of things, and I've been praying, you know, for 15 years. You know, every day when I pray, I always ask the Lord for wisdom, you know, because it says in James, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask, and God loves to give it liberally, and he doesn't hold back the wisdom that he gives us. And so I always ask the Lord for more wisdom, brothers and sisters, and about him. And about his kingdom and about his word and all that. So that's what you got to do. Just keep seeking him for more wisdom. And when the Lord gives you a little something, I'm guilty of it too. You know, but when the Lord gives you something, if you will search it out and follow it up, he'll give you more. But if you don't search it out, you know, the Lord won't keep, just like if the Lord keeps giving you dreams and you don't write it down and try to pray for the interpretation, God won't keep giving you dreams. You know, you got to act on the light that he gave you, and then he'll give you more. I mean, so, you know, because with God, as I was telling Brother Gary, Bear 049, you know, God's desire for us is for us to keep seeking him out. You know, it's like a dad playing hide and go seek with his little kid. The Lord always wants us to keep trying to find him and seek him, but he's there the whole time. So his desire is for us to draw closer to him and change our character, make us better people, all those things. It's a process. It's really true. All things work together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purposes. Romans 8:28. So God loves to keep drawing us in to him. And that's the beauty of our Lord and our Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. And you know, when I make these videos, I'm not mad. It's righteous indignation by the Spirit of God. That's the politically correct term, biblically correct term, righteous indignation, as the Lord is leading me, you know, because of my flesh. As a human, I'm not, you know, it's by the Spirit of God. God bless you guys. Love you all.